joy it is that we can gather this day and worship our Lord together. We are going to continue our sermon series, The Hymns of Our Faith, the hymns we sing. And we would be so remiss if we did not have a Sunday dedicated to Charles Wesley. I mean, he was a very prolific hymn writer. It was said that he wrote about 6,500 hymns, and most of them were written after they talk about John's conversion in 1738 when his heart was strangely warmed, but interestingly enough, his brother Charles had a pretty dramatic conversion as well about 3 days prior to John's conversion. And so after this dramatic conversion of faith, he began writing all these hymns. In fact, it is said that there was not a single scripture nor theological thought that he did not pen a hymn to. And so he wrote all of these hymns. And most of them were put to more popular tunes, even bar tunes, because what he wanted to do was to really bring the Bible to life, bring these theological thoughts about grace and salvation, forgiveness, sin, all of that to the ordinary people, to the working class. In fact, that was what that was the goal of both John and Charles Wesley. And so he wanted this theology of grace to be remembered. And the best way to remember, it's how we all learn the ABCs, by learning a song. And so that's what Charles did. He put this theology of grace to music. And so we're going to be looking at one of Charles Wesley's hymns today as I tell a story about Charles Wesley and his hymn writing. So after we get started, I'll open us with prayer, but I'll also pass the basket, so please be sure to drop your contact card in. And if you are worshiping with us online, just say good morning so we can know who's here. So as we begin this time of worship, let us pray. Good and gracious God, your love endures forever. And we are so grateful for this time of worship, to be reminded of your grace that is greater than our sin, to be reminded that we were created in your image, to be reminded that we are the works of your hands. So anoint us now with your Spirit as we pray, as we sing, as we worship you. In the name of Jesus Christ, your Son and our Savior. Amen. Elizabeth?
Good morning, everyone. Let's stand to sing and tell your neighbors hello. Tell everyone hi.
In the land.
Filled up fast just during that song about you'll come. You all showed up. Wow. So sometimes you hear a testimony from someone and they speak the truth from their heart, and it's like as you're listening to them, you're just like, yes, that's it. That was God. And it's because we've all experienced him. I know when my brother passed away, I shared with a few people how when I arrived at my parents' house, I knew Jesus was there. I could feel it. And I wasn't happy about it at the time. It seemed like bad news in a way. But when I share that with people, several people who have had similar experiences said, yes, I know exactly what you're talking about. Like, I felt that too. And when I hear John Wesley's story and I hear about his conversion, It warms my heart when I hear it. But the first job I took at a Methodist church, I had directed at a few Catholic churches in my 20s. But then when I met RL, I was mostly like a bar musician. I was gigging for a living. And every now and then I'd play and sing a service, and I would like crush it and be like, well, maybe I'm just meant to like do this every now and then, you know? And she hired me to lead worship at their contemporary service, which I had never done anything like that. And I remember my first weekend, she asked me if I could sing a contemporary song at the traditional service as well, as like a, well, you know, to introduce me to the both congregations. And the first thing I noticed at that service was the singing, you know, like the way that this Methodist church was singing the hymns. I was like I felt it in my heart. It's like, this is worship. They mean this, you know? And it was different than what I had experienced singing like Gregorian chant and stuff in the Catholic Church, where participation is not encouraged. You know, it's about the listening and having your spiritual life be kind of outside of you, like something to aim for outside of you. And it was amazing to me to experience that kind of hymn singing. And I experienced that in the Methodist Church. And so every time I hear the story of John Wesley and how his heart was strangely moved, I think, yes, that's exactly what it's like. And God moves through our lives in very mysterious ways, and sometimes through the scariest of times. You know, I was talking to RL's grandsons right before worship about moving, and you know, because they're about to be, their mom has been transferred to a new church. And so we were talking about just newness and starting over. And that can be very scary. And it's scary for us too when something big changes. But God has this way of moving through us and being present with us. And it's up to us to feel that he's there. And so as we all navigate this world and this life, let's just take a second to acknowledge that God is constantly preparing us for something new. And sometimes, Lord, when we feel like we're buried alive, it's actually that you've planted us. We're not buried, we're planted. And so we ask that you continue to show us your light in the world. Help us to notice you in the little things. Help us to find joy in you so that when we get to heaven, your name is the only name that matters. Your name is fresh on our lips because Jesus has been the theme of our lives. For it is in Jesus' name that we pray and sing this morning. Amen.
To be God, I came.
crushing that new wine is made. And when we are pressed, when we are squeezed, that is when we really can see our faith being transformed and acknowledge the fact that God is with us through all things that we face. So we lift in prayer today some folks where we know God is already ahead of us doing good work. We are praying for Mark's mom, Joy Atwood. She's been moved now to Riverside Rehab Hospital and is responding well to the physical therapy that they're giving her. Lots of company, so is in great spirits, so we're grateful for that. We want to lift in prayer Kim Sumrall's grandmother, Eloise. She's at Rapids Hospital. She fell at the nursing home this week and I guess broke her hip because they did hip surgery on her toward the end of this week, yesterday or the day before, Friday or Saturday. So we want to definitely lift her in prayer. Rebecca, we continue to pray for your brother and lift him in prayer as well. And then a prayer of praise. Rusty and I went Friday to his oncologist to see the PET scan, and the news was wonderful. We'd been praying for the tumor in his neck to totally disappear, and it has. They can't see it at all on the PET scan. And then, I know, we celebrate that. And the other tumor under his arm that started as big as a cannonball is now about the size of a marble. And so now we're waiting to hear back from the surgeon. So he could be headed to surgery pretty quickly. So we're just grateful to just be a recipient of a miracle of God and to be sustained by your prayers. So thank you for all of that. Some birthdays this week. Sue Richmond has a birthday. Brandon Tubbs has a birthday on Thursday. And then Charles Brooks, right? Saturday has a birthday. So we thank God for their life and their life among us. So let us go to the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, make us one with you, one with each other, one with your Holy Spirit here in your holy church. Help us to see your presence. Help us to feel you burning in our hearts for other people. And grant that we may be united in a fellowship of love and prayer. Give us the courage to pick up our cross and respond to the needs of those in our world today. Give us the stamina to follow you, to be your hands and feet and your heart in the world. Enable us to be a witness to your grace and mercy in all times and in all places. Sharpen our faith in you that we may have the confidence to withstand the trials, the struggles, the obstacles, and the temptations that come our way. For we know that we do not need faith in ourselves to have faith, but what we need is to only have faith in you, for that is more than enough. And now forgive us, Lord, when we have turned away from the one who has created us, even when we have lived in the grip that has drawn our gaze away from you. Even when we have been oblivious, even when we followed a path fashioned of nothing but our own desires, even when we wandered far and willfully away, even when we forget to look past our own feet and forget to see the wonders, not of our making, but by your mighty hand alone. Even when we have failed to stand in awe and to breathe in thankfulness, to lean into your love that has waited for us with open arms, even then, help us to remember that there is and always will be your grace. Turn our hearts toward you, O Lord, and to your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, you might want to grab a hymnal, because we're going to look at hymn number 385, a Wesleyan hymn called Let Us Plead for Faith Alone. It was written by Charles Wesley. It was one of the first hymns that he wrote. It was certainly in his first collection called the Foundry Collection, because when John and Charles Wesley began their Methodist movement, the Holy Club, they met in this abandoned metalworks factory called a foundry. And so they met in this foundry, and they called it the Foundry Meeting House. And that was where they really wanted to emphasize the zeal for Methodism, the zeal for Christ. And so this hymn, Let Us Plead for Faith Alone, was one of those early Methodist songs sung by the people in that metalworks factory, in that metalworks foundry. And it was inspired by Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. It was inspired by this scripture. I'll be reading from the New International Version. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Let us pray. Almighty God, still the busyness of our minds and open our hearts to you, that we may hear your word for us this day. Amen. Well, I want to share with you a little century-old wisdom. I guess it was last week, I visited the oldest member of our church, Virginia Rand, who is 104 years old. She'll be 105 in September. And so when I entered her home, I was shown to the living room to wait for her arrival. And here she comes unaided, walking into her living room all by herself. Of course, she steadied herself with her walker, and I stood to greet her. And I mean, she just looks fantastic. And I said, Virginia, I said, I want to be drinking what you're drinking. And she says, well, I don't know what that is, because it comes to me pre-mixed. So then we sat down and we visited and we talked of life and family, and she began to talk about her son and Janet Rand Whittle, that you know is a member here, and she said to me, she said, you know, one of the things that I appreciate most about Janet, and I said, no, what is that? She says, the fact that we both love my son so much. I know, and I thought, you know, that is a true statement for all of us, that, you know, that is the common denominator in life for all of us, and it is the core to this verse this morning that I read from Ephesians, because it's about God's unconditional love for us. That is what unites all of us, is God's unconditional love that God has for all people. That's why God sent his one and only son to live among us in this world. It is why his son chose to be sacrificed on a cross, which brought about the forgiveness of our sins. And that forgiveness, when we realize that for ourselves, when we see that, that we are forgiven, well, it brings about a change of heart. And that change of heart, well, it makes us love God and love God's people the same way that God loves us. Do you see how it makes a full circle? How unconditional love of God for us comes around full circle so that we will have unconditional love for others. Paul puts it this way: by grace you have been saved as a gift from God, not by works, so that no one can boast or brag. In other words, salvation cannot be gained from our own efforts. It's not something that we can do ourselves. Salvation is not of our own doing. Salvation is a gift to us from God. Salvation is God's doing for us on our behalf. Our good works, our good deeds, well, they don't win us favor with God. It doesn't work like that. Instead, our works, our good deeds are an outgrowth. They are like a fruit that is ripened out of our love and out of our faith for God. So here's where we get to start. Here's where we start fooling ourselves when we think about God's forgiveness for us. We often think mistakenly that we have to work our way into heaven, and that's not true. We're also mistaken if we think that God is not going to accept us until we cease to be a sinner, that God's not going to accept a sinner until we cease to be one. And if that were the case, well, then heaven's going to be pretty darn empty when we get there, right? God and Jesus are the only one that could ever claim to be sinless. Well, we know that's not going to be true. We know that there is hope for all of us. Here's what gets us in. It's not the works. It's grace. Grace gets us into heaven, and it's free. It's a free gift to us from God. God's love, God's unconditional love for us, his grace, his mercy, the forgiveness of our sins, they're all rolled up into one nice, neat little package called salvation. But here's where we also kind of catch ourselves. We think that good works cannot and will not produce salvation. It's like the chicken and the egg question. What comes first? Well, what comes first is salvation. It has to. It has to come first. We cannot win our way into heaven. We cannot work our way into heaven either. God's good works are not like extra credit that you get from a teacher. You know, when you're failing a class or you need to bring a grade up, you go to the teacher and say, hey, can I do some extra credit? You know, if I do this, can I bring this failing grade up to a passing grade? If we think that that's what our good works are, that we're sitting in God's classroom and we have to do good works to get a passing grade, then we are fooling ourselves. We are turning good works into, we're equating it to our level of performance. It becomes a sporting event, and grace is not like that at all. That is not how grace works. That is not how forgiveness works. If we see that grace is our ticket into heaven, our ticket to get into God's good grace, then we have not come face to face with our sin. And if we do not come face to face with our sin, then we have not encountered what it means, nor have we accepted God's forgiveness for our lives that is freely given to each and every one of us, to every prodigal son, to every tax collector, to every prostitute, to every thief on the cross, to everyone, you and me. Grace is given to all of us free of charge as a gift from God. And that's what Charles Wesley is singing about in that hymn, number 385. And in fact, it's more like a poem that he put to music, Let Us Plead for Faith Alone. A hymn that Charles Wesley wrote after he and his brother had gone to Georgia. They'd been sent to the American colonies. You know, they were sent to convert the Native Americans and to bring a more religious presence to those that were early settlers that were forming that colony. Well, that trip was a disaster. disaster, especially for John and Charles too, but mostly John Wesley, because, well, he had this crush on this girl who happened to be the daughter of the guy that was the head of the colony. And John, being the workaholic that he is, or played too hard to get or something, because then this girl that he was crushing on had eyes for another fella. And when she wound up marrying him, John refused to serve her communion. And it was just a disaster. He really aggravated the guy who was the head of the colony, so much so that John and Charles had to go back to London in the middle of the night by boat. It was also on this trip that the trip was made a disaster by the fact that the boat that they were on was in a storm, faced high seas, the mast, you know, that holds the sails, broke in half. There, John and Charles, you know, down in the belly of the boat, in the corner, crying and screaming, you know, afraid for their lives. And in the galley were these Moravian men who were just singing praise to God. They were just as calm and relaxed. They didn't care what was going on in the seas. You know, they didn't care if they lived or died. They just were sitting there praising God. And John and Charles both were just kind of taken aback by this behavior. And when they kissed the ground, you know, when they got to dry land and they kissed the ground, they turned to them and they said, "Weren't you afraid of dying?" And the response was, "Thank God, no." That was the kind of faith that they had in the face of disaster. And John and Charles realized they didn't have that kind of faith. That was not the faith that they had. So they actually sought out, when they got back to London, they sought out Peter Bowler, who was of the Moravian faith, and he became their mentor. And he told them both, preach faith until you have it, and then when you have it, when you have faith, then when you have it, you will preach faith. Preach faith until you have it, and then when you have it, you will preach faith. Well, both John and Charles took that to heart. And so faith is what this hymn is all about that Charles wrote. Faith that comes from God's justifying grace. Faith that comes from a grace that forgives us of our sins. Grace that is freely given to all. And that when it's given to us, when it's given to you, when it's given to me, it makes us want to act right, do right, be right. Not because we have to. Not because we are forced to act right, do right, be right. Not because it's an obligation or under compulsion. We don't act right, do right, be right because it's law and we're afraid we're going to get arrested, or because, you know, our mamas told us that's how we're supposed to be. That's not why we act right, do right, be right when we've experienced God's pardoning grace. We do it because we are changed people and we've had a change of heart. Verse 1 of that hymn clearly states that faith alone precedes our works. Let us plead for faith alone, faith by which our works is shown. God it is who justifies, only faith the grace applies. Verse 2 declares that the source of this grace, the source of this pardoning power, comes from God, which is one, within each and every one of us, and two, stronger than anything we will ever face, stronger than any temptation, obstacle, anything. Active faith that lives within, conquers hell and death and sin, hallows whom it first made whole, forms this Savior in the soul. And finally, verses 3 and 4, let us for this faith contend. Sure salvation is the end. Heaven already is begun. Every everlasting life is won. Only let us persevere till we see our Lord appear. Never from the rock remove, saved by faith which works by love. This stresses that our faith leads us to heaven and ultimately into the presence of Christ Jesus himself. And that our faith, that our works, that our actions, well, those are our response to God's love working in each of us. It's our ticket to heaven, all right, but the ticket's already been paid for by Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen and amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for your justifying grace that has forgiven us, that has helped us come face to face with our sin and your goodness for us. So Lord, change our hearts so that we might live for you and love others. This is truly our prayer, O Lord. Amen. You know, we are reminded each week of that justifying grace that forgives when we are gathered at this table. You know, it gives us the opportunity to reflect. What have I done this week? What have I left undone? Where do I need to be forgiven? Where do I need to have a change of heart? Who do I need to forgive myself? This table is the great example of God's sacrificial and unconditional love for each of us. For we are reminded of that night that Jesus gathered at the table with his disciples. He took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it, he gave it to them and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you." And in like manner, he took the cup, he blessed it. He gave it to them and he said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Almighty God, send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world redeemed, forgiven by the blood of the cross, so that we might be made whole, so that we might be prepared to go forth and serve, be your hands and feet in the world today. This truly is our prayer, O Lord. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we are reminded that we are one body, and just like this bread, we must be broken open, just like the cup poured out, so that we can make room for the Holy Spirit that makes us whole. And the cup of blessing in which we share, is it not a means of sharing in all the blessings that Christ has in store for each of us? So the table has been set. All are welcome. You do not have to be a member of the church. You do not have to be United Methodist to receive. We share a common loaf, but we have individual cups. And if you prefer prepackaged, we have that as well. So come. The Lord invites and welcomes all to his table.
Thank you.
today is number 385, Let Us Plead for Faith Alone, number 385.
Just a few things to help us connect into the life of the church. One, we are starting two new Sunday school classes. The first one begins next Sunday. It's going to be in the Stepping Stones room. It's called Serendipity. Gladys and Glenn Miller will be leading that. It'll be a Bible-based search for some of life's truths to difficult questions. And then August 13th, I'll be leading a class for our folks, our younger folks, our parents of children and youth. We're going to be in the Johnson Center, and we're going to be looking at also some real-life answers to real-life struggles. Reminder that on July 23rd, the Southern Plainsmen are coming as a part of our Hymns of Faith, so we'll have one service at
10 o'clock,
that's right, in the sanctuary. Music camp starts tomorrow. Anything we need to know? Anything you still need?
You know, if you have kids and you missed sign up, you can bring them at 3:30 for the open session. That's when the band will be answering the kids' questions and showing the kids how to jam out and dance. And so all kids are welcome to that. Maybe some adults too.
Yeah. Can I dance?
If you need to know things, like, you can definitely dance.
The backpack mission, so Sunday is the last Sunday to, this next Sunday, the 16th, is the last Sunday to bring supplies, because we're going to fill those backpacks because we're giving them away at the Bolton Bash that will be here on the 31st. So we got to get all that ready to do the 100 backpacks. Also, families of children and youth, there is a barbecue at the Tub House on the 16th. Starting at 5:45, you should get something in the mail. If you don't, we will get that word out to you. And then last but certainly not least, you probably got in the mail this week a word about the All Things Bright and Beautiful campaign. We have a little renovation, a big renovation of our stained glass window coming, so I hope that you will prayerfully consider how you will participate in that. Your pastor and your leadership board have stepped up to lead from the front, and 100% of our leadership has participated in this campaign, and we would like for you to help us also complete that work as well. So if you have any questions about that, about the work, I'm glad to answer anything that you might have, but just ask you to prayerfully consider to participate. Elizabeth?
For the Sunday school classes, you just show up, right?
You just show up.
You just pray about it and show up.
Yep.
Cool. So if I didn't have baby fever before the service, I definitely have it now. We had some adorable young worshipers with us today. Exactly. Right?
I know, we got another baby on the way.
Oh, so amazing. Wow. RL, I loved when you said that our ticket to heaven has already been paid for.
Yes.
That speaks to me. Let's stand and sing together.
One.
starts with the confidence that you are loved unconditionally, that you are forgiven, and that you are sent forth to love others where you work, where you play, and where you live. And may the peace of God be with you this day and forevermore. Amen.